I would like to thank Tanzania Media Women's Association for assisting us in arranging this press conference. And it's a well-attended press conference, which is fantastic. I'm glad to see both national and local media. We're here for the release of a report, and we'll hear more about that in a while from my two dear friends and colleagues, Dr. Berta Maega, who is representing EAAPA, East African Alcohol Policy Alliance. I think she's in a position to mention what that is later. Mike Dumbier, or how do you want to pronounce your name?
Dumbia.
Yeah, pretty close.
Yeah, very close.
Thank you. And your actual title is lobbying?
I'm the director of strategy and advocacy at IOGT International.
Yeah. EAAPA stands for East African Alcohol Policy Alliance, and it's composed of networks or alliances from countries that form the East African community, the new East African community. And the reason why this alliance was formed was recognition of the growing alcohol problem in our region.
Yes, thank you, Bertha, for introducing EAAPA a little bit. As you have heard, Johan introduced me very kindly. I work for IOGT International. And IOGT International is a global umbrella organization of 122 civil society organizations from 54 countries. And what we do in IOGT International is we work with political processes, mainly on global level, but also on regional level, to address the harm caused by alcohol and other drugs. So IOGT International today is the premier global network for evidence-based policy measures and community-based interventions to reduce and prevent harm caused by alcohol and other drugs. And the background is that in 3 days' time, global leaders, including the leaders from all East African countries, come together in New York for a historic and monumental event, which is the UN Summit on the Sustainable Development Goals. So in a few days' time, the global community will adopt totally new Sustainable Development Goals. Those are the follow-up to the Millennium Development Goals. We finance this new development agenda, and this is where we think this report fits in. It's about this new development agenda that will be adopted in 3-4 days' time. It's very ambitious, it's very visionary, and to make it come true, to actually achieve it by 2030, the governments need to raise revenues, they need to invest money into these 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And we think, and our report shows that by using alcohol taxation, governments will be in the position to raise revenue. Our four simple messages are, we say that alcohol taxation is a win-win measure. And win-win means that by using alcohol taxation, Bertha touched upon it a little bit. By using alcohol taxation, you reduce alcohol harm in your countries. It's actually one of the best measures that we know in the world to do that. So you improve public health, and at the same time you raise revenue that you can invest for development purposes and health promotion purposes. So in that sense, we think alcohol taxation is a wonderful win-win measure. And the report puts forward a lot of evidence from all around the world. The second key message for us is that alcohol is an obstacle to development, and there is no better place in the world to see that and to experience this than East Africa. It's simple, and you just need to go into the communities here and you can see what ELCO does to individuals, families, communities and societies as a whole. Look, working on this report, we realized that ELCO has a negative impact on 11 out of those 17 sustainable development goals. So it's very clear, and if you look through the report, you can see that ELCO is an obstacle to development and it needs to be addressed. The third key message that we have is that right now ELCO taxation and ELCO policy in general is a powerful tool, but it's underutilized. If you compare it to tobacco taxation, governments are not really interested in talking about ELCO taxation. And one reason is the powerful ELCO industry, who lobbies aggressively in all those countries here in East Africa, and Bertha will talk a little bit about it. So there's huge potential in using ELCO taxation. We are not tapping into this potential right now, especially in the low and middle income countries. And fourth key message from the report is that using ELCO taxation as this powerful tool, as this win-win measure, as the report presents it, reaps positive benefits across 10 sustainable development goals. Just to give you a feeling of what those 10 can be, I will not mention all of those, but it's poverty reduction, reduction of hunger and starvation, health promotion and promotion of well-being, but it's also quality education. It's also, I think everyone understands that, gender equality, reducing, preventing violence against women. It's also creating safer cities, safer public spaces, and it's also economic growth and the promotion of economic prosperity. So those are our four messages. This is how what we found putting together this report.
Households suffer a lot. The social cost of alcohol excessive drinking is huge. With this new proposition that taxation from alcohol alcohol sales and production should be used to address some of these problems, I think it has come at the right time. And if it can be seen through properly, so that proper accountability is done to address the specific problems that are related to alcohol use, then I think we have some hope for the future.
Yeah. Well, rather, transactions in alcohol produced products directly will raise more problems to the society, because maybe most of the society deals with local alcohols. How do you put an effort on it about local alcohols?
You have a valid point there. Generally, when we talk about taxation, is to do with industrially produced commodities. But I'm sure where the local or the homemade rooms are sold, they are also if they are getting legal licenses, they are also paying something. If we are serious and if we have the political will to incorporate this kind of thing, I think it's possible, because there is Serikali right down to the Mabalozi and even at household. Because those people, even those who are making Longo, the neighborhood will know. And if there is a political will, we could work at those as well. And it needs sensitization, education, and empowerment of the leadership at that level. So it is possible to do taxing even at that level, but what we need is political will and awareness of all who are involved.
Do you think it's high time to legalize, these local groups?
So issue and legalization is not, that's not an issue. The issue is how you restrict it so that it doesn't harm the people, but it can pay for some of the harms that are.
What I can add, thank you for your question. It's a very important question, and my answer is simple. It's not an either or proposition. You have to address the harm caused by illicit brew, informal brew. But we know this, the alcohol industry, those are mainly Western multinational companies. They come from Europe and North America. They are targeting your countries, Tanzania, many other sub-Saharan African countries. And if I travel around only Arusha, I can see all the billboards. Those are not local brewers who put up all those billboards. Those are big alcohol companies, and they raise the money through selling alcohol, but then they leave society paying for the costs. So the conversation about alcohol taxation is very simple. It's just to make sure that the alcohol industry also pays the bill for the costs that their products cause in Tanzania and East Africa.
I've just come to understand you are doing something good for our community. How is our governments, the policymakers, related to you, to what you are doing?
You understand, I work on the global level. So we actually, IOGT International and the Health Ministry of Tanzania, we sit in the same boat when it comes to global processes. We work together for regulating the alcohol industry when we meet in Geneva or when we meet in New York. We work together on making sure that alcohol policy is used to reduce violence against women. And I have had a couple of conversations with the government from your country about that topic. And we make sure that in those global processes to address health epidemics, that we use alcohol policy. Then the question becomes, what does the government do here in Tanzania?
As I explained, the East African Alcohol Policy Alliance is an advocate for good policy that regulates alcohol so that it doesn't do harm to our people. So the way we relate is through advocacy and lobbying for evidence-based policy, and that's why we're here. And also for you media people to help us send this message across that alcohol is an intoxicating drug. Nidawa nikilevi. So we are working with policymakers and the governments to educate them, but also to convince them that it is important to regulate and not just leave it to the industries. The challenge with this is that the industry is also working hard. Like you see all those advertisements on the roads, in our media, in the newspapers, in the radio, television, all over. And those are the kind of things that do not happen in the Western world where the industries come from. But they do it in our countries because it's allowed and our laws are not there to protect us, especially our children. And most of those are directed to the youth so that they get attracted. And once you are hooked, when you are young, they have business for the rest of your life. We all have something to do to protect this generation and the next.